Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Jerome Kim here. He is the Director General of the International Vaccine Institute. He is an international expert on vaccines. We're going to learn all about COVID-19, the vaccines, and what to expect. So this is going to be a fascinating show. I hope you stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this message.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Dr. Jerome Kim, who is the Director General of the International Vaccine Institute, IVI, and an international expert on the evaluation and development of vaccines. It's so nice to have you here, Dr. Kim.
It's my pleasure, Diane.
Well, I was looking forward to this because we were introduced through our mutual friend, Rich Lofgren, and I know you're doing some interesting work in the area of just looking at vaccines, and I know COVID-19 is such a huge problem in the world, and you've done work with cholera vaccine, and I was looking at just the list of things. So before I give too much information, I'd like to hear it from you of what you've worked on and how you got to this level.
It's kind of a long story, but, you know, it's a wonderful thing when the military will pay for medical school. And
yes.
So, you know, and they did that. And I was working on HIV at Duke, and I thought I was going to go on and do faculty stuff. And I got my first grant. And I wrote back to the Air Force and said, hey, can I have a further deferment? And it was the start of the Gulf War. And they said, wait a second. Where are you? And why aren't you in the Air Force? And before I knew it, I was assigned to Wall Street Army Institute of Research, working for a guy named Bob Redfield, who is now the director of CDC,
right,
and doing HIV vaccine research. And then right after that, you know, Bob left, and I left with him to go to the University of Maryland, and eventually Debbie Birx invited me back into the Army to work on HIV vaccine. So, so I go back long ways with them. And so we worked on HIV vaccines. And, you know, at the end of 20 years, after having done a phase 3 trial in Thailand that was the first and actually at this point still the only trial that showed an HIV vaccine could protect against infection, I was eligible to retire. And the job at IVI opened up. And, you know, IVI works on everything but HIV. And it was a perfect way to complement an interest that I had in understanding how, you know, other vaccines are developed. And so, you know, the beauty of IVI is it's an international organization, which is a little odd, you know, kind of like the United Nations or WHO. But it's really the only international organization that actually develops vaccines. So, you know, rather than, you know, publish great papers in Science, Nature, and Cell, I mean, we really focus on, like a little company, on getting a vaccine from our laboratory through all the stages of testing. We transfer it to a company that can make it. We help the company usually with funding from the Gates Foundation or Korea or Sweden or India, one of our state funders, and we get it approved. And World Health Organization approves it. It's eligible for purchase by UN organizations. And you know, the oral cholera vaccine developed at IVI is 80 to 90% of the current stockpile. We don't benefit from it, but we've made a vaccine that the world benefits from. And We have a typhoid vaccine that's in late phase 3 now. And now we're working on other vaccines. We're trying to figure out, you know, what the next vaccine will be. But our model is identify a disease that's a big problem in developing countries, learn how to make a vaccine that will work against it, work with funders and companies to make a vaccine, prove that it works, get it tested, get it approved, and then, you know, make sure that countries are available, have it available to use. And COVID's a lot like that.
You know, there's just so many things. I'm trying to decide which way I want to go first, because there's so much out there. Having worked in pharmaceutical sales, I dealt more with bacteria than virus, and I sold so many different drugs in the past, and it was so challenging. At one point I sold Cipro and those type of drugs, and one of the hardest things to learn is all the pathogen names and all the things that go along with it. But you know what, the biggest thing I learned is when I actually got, I ended up with meningitis later, and had viral meningitis and not bacterial meningitis, which I heard eventually that was a good thing to do. And, you, and in our minds, we think of viruses almost worse than bacteria because we have these medications for the bacterial infections. And you know, the virus, you don't hear so many helpful solutions. But I guess when I had meningitis, they told me the bacteria left behind much worse remnants, I guess. And that was why it was so dangerous. And it was good that I had viral meningitis instead of the other. But I don't know why we, I guess a lot of people are confused, I guess, between the virus and the bacteria, why we're able to get some of these bacterial medications and why it's so hard to get a virus, you know, anything to cure a virus. Why is it so difficult?
Yeah, that's a great question. Maybe not for a vaccine person, but I think I can answer it. You know, the thing about viruses is, you know, one really famous scientist called them a piece of bad news wrapped up in protein. And it's, you know, bacteria are different from us. Mm-hmm. You know, they have their own machinery inside them, and some very particular ways that they're, you know, bacteria have to reproduce and, I mean, in other words, grow. Very particular things that are very bacteria specific about the way they make protein, or the way they make the outer coat. And that, and the fact that that is different makes it possible to target. So antibiotics will target different parts of the bacterium. So some of them will affect, you know, the outer cell wall of the bacterium, like the penicillins and and the cephalosporins. Right. Others will target the little machine inside the bacterium that makes protein called the ribosome, very different from our ribosome. So you can give a bacterium something that stops their ribosome, and it won't harm the human ribosome, which is great. The problem with viruses is they're a little bit incomplete. So they need to grow inside of us in order, you know, inside one of our cells. Mm-hmm. So they almost take over some of the human cellular machinery. That makes them very hard to target sometimes, because we can't just knock out the, you know, the ribosome, the human ribosome that makes protein, to stop the virus, because when we do that, we'll stop the human ribosomes elsewhere in the body. So what we have to do is look for things that the virus has. So for instance, with HIV, there's something called reverse transcriptase, and it turns the RNA from the HIV virus into DNA, which then becomes a part of us. But we can target that reverse transcriptase because it really doesn't have a human homolog. There's not a similar protein in humans. Mm-hmm. So we can make all these drugs against the reverse transcriptase, and that's how the first effective therapies against HIV were developed. So viruses are a little different. Right. It's still possible to target them, but it's a little more difficult.
Well, you know, my husband is a physician, and he was talking to me about when they created the polio vaccine to eradicate polio, that they were in a hurry, and they got some batches that weren't really complete yet. And I'm thinking about that with COVID and what we're working on now. And I think I thought he told me that they gave this, some of them, to people and actually didn't have the dead version. They had a live version of the polio. Now people actually got polio. Is that a true story, first of all? And is that something we're going to have to worry about with COVID? And just tell me a little bit about the what's going on with the COVID and the worries and the things that we have to think about.
Yeah. That's actually, it is a true story, the Qatar incident. Mm-hmm. And it was, you know, we've evolved a lot in terms of vaccine manufacturing and vaccine safety. Mm-hmm. In those days, you know, the polio vaccine was brand new. At that point, we didn't have many vaccines against viruses. I mean, if you think about it, the influenza virus, the influenza vaccine was tested near the end of World War II. And we'd had smallpox, but that was a kind of chance discovery, you know, 100 and at that point, maybe about 150 years before. And it was a related, you know, virus called cowpox, and, you know, Edward Jenner found it, and, you know, lo and behold, milkmaids didn't get smallpox. Why? Because they were exposed to cowpox. Cowpox protected them. He turned it into a vaccine, and, you know, that was an amazing discovery. But between then and, you know, the development of the next set of very effective antiviral vaccines was a long time. And so finally, we learned how to grow these viruses in what we call cell culture. So we could actually grow them in a test tube. And once you could grow them, you could kill them. And, you know, the first virus, the first vaccines were just growing up vaccine, killing it, and injecting it.
Right.
And that's essentially what they did with the Salk polio vaccine. Salk grew it up in cells, inactivated it, and injected it. And the problem with that is if you're not following high standards for quality, occasionally a batch gets through that's not completely killed.
Bad for polio.
So that's back in the 1950s. And, you know, we've come a long way since then. And, you know, there are now international standards for manufacturing quality called GMP, Good Manufacturing Practices. And countries around the world, you know, including all the major manufacturers of vaccines, have adopted GMP practices. And organizations like the Food and Drug Administration are very stringent in the way that they, you know, require companies to show that you know, to show their work, that everything at every step is controlled. So we hope that we won't have problems like that. We have mechanisms in place, and, you know, companies in North America, Europe, Japan, Australia know how to do this, and they've been doing it, you know, repetitively. And, you know, vaccines these days, especially those licensed in the United States or in Europe, are both safe and efficacious. I mean, you know, a colleague at the University of Pennsylvania makes this point that, you know, the average American parent has not seen measles, probably hasn't seen chickenpox because of the vaccine, or mumps. Yet they consent to give their children these vaccines because they are assured that the vaccines are safe and efficacious. And really, that is the thing that we hold as vaccine developers to a very high standard, because people trust us that these vaccines are going to work and that they're not going to harm people. And so, you know, when you think about a COVID vaccine and you think about, you know, cutting corners or rushing or approvals that haven't really met all of the FDA's rules and regulations, it makes you worry that maybe we're slipping in terms of that commitment to safety and efficacy. And that's why the FDA has said over and over again, actually, the head of the FDA published a paper in the Journal of the American Medical Association that says, we will not stint on safety. Actually, just recently, Dr. Hahn did. So again, I mean, it's really the basis for their credibility. And, you know, the reputation that the US FDA has worldwide is one of, you know, it's a highly stringent national regulatory authority. And it's something that, you know, the FDA says it's true, it's going to be safe and effective. And they don't want to lose that. And so I think they're nervous when people talk about, you know, well, we're going to expedite this. We're going to, you know, issue the approval at a certain date. I mean, until we see the data and we know that it's safe and effective, I don't think they'll want to do it. Well, again, that's just, I'm not an FDA.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because I think of drugs that I've worked with. And before I sold Cipro, we had a drug called Omniflox that they had approved by the FDA, which was similar to Cipro. And it did, you know, it looked great. And then you got on the market and we saw some issues and they had to take it off. And so, you know, you don't know what you're going to see. And I'm thinking about the FDA and the World Health. And I mean, I remember just the drugs that we would sell, you know, maybe a dose would be something here in the U.S. It'd become something different in different countries. When you do a vaccine like this, is it the same throughout the world, or is it different like it is with pharmaceuticals, where it can vary country to country?
So it depends on the company. Mm-hmm. But typically a company that makes a vaccine is going to make one form.
Okay.
And the reason is, you know, vaccines are biologicals. And they're also given to healthy people to keep them healthy. And so the standard for establishing safety and efficacy is slightly different. So, you know, a phase three trial with a vaccine is not a few hundred people or a thousand people. It's at least 3,000. That's both the WHO and FDA minimum standard. But it can involve, you know, tens of thousands of people. So you see the COVID trials are between 20 and 40,000. There have been larger trials. You know, our HIV vaccine trial, which was not a true phase three, but a phase 2B trial, was 16,000 people. And that helps you to establish a very broad baseline for side effects in a normal population. So typically, anything over 3,000 gives you pretty good read on rare side effects. The one thing that we can't predict, and so this is where, you know, continued follow-up and really careful attention to safety is important for vaccines. You know, we're pretty sure that we vaccinate people in a phase three trial, thousands of people, tens of thousands of people are followed for a year, 2 years, and the vaccine appears safe. What we don't know is maybe 3 years or 4 years or 5 years, as the immune responses, the defensive response against the vaccine begins to decrease, are we going to see something bad happen? And that actually just happened with one of the Sanofi vaccines, a vaccine against the viral disease called dengue. Mm-hmm. And it turned out that it looked great at year one and year two. But starting in after year two, you started to see maybe a suggestion that there might be worse disease in people who had never been exposed to dengue before.
Great.
And, you know, as a result, the company actually intensified its effort to understand that question and actually answered it definitively. And in fact, there was a problem. So they had to change the recommendations. But again, you know, this is a vaccine that was in, you know, thousands of people in order to try to evaluate the fact that it was safe and effective. And it wasn't until much later that side effect appeared. So, you know, they commit to initial safety and efficacy, and then they also have to commit to longer term. And for COVID, you know, that Sanofi vaccine was in development for years.
Right.
COVID vaccines will be in development for a year. And so the companies and the organizations, countries, are going to need to commit to continuing to follow up those volunteers because, you know, volunteers in vaccine trials are, in a sense, very brave, right? They're taking a vaccine that no one knows the safety or efficacy for, and they're consenting to be, you know, vaccinated with an experimental vaccine. And so we really owe it to them to be able to say, you know, thank you for what you're doing, and we're going to do everything we can to make sure that nothing bad happens to you. And by and large, they do. So that's important commitment.
Well, I realize that everybody's trying really hard to get the right answer. And I look at some of the background in my family. My father actually was born blind from having my grandmother had the Spanish flu when she was pregnant with him. And I look at the flu, you know, as a separate thing, just because that happened to my father. And then my grandfather, when he was in his 80s, took a flu shot and almost died from the reaction to it. But a year later, for some reason, he did it again. And then he ended up dying and having bad reactions just to the flu shot. So I'm not a huge fan of taking flu shots for that reason, because we don't react really well. And, you know, you think about some of the things when you said the dengue thing, I'm thinking, is it better to get the flu than to take a flu shot? Is it better to get COVID than to take the risk of what you could get when they go, oh, wait a minute, look what we found?
Yes. Yeah, so, you know, and again, this just gets to how we evaluate safety and, you know, and how you appreciate risk. And to some extent, you know, you're taking the, you know, often, you know, in the U.S., there's a nearly universal recommendation for the use of flu vaccine. In the same way that, you know, we have a nearly universal recommendation for the use of masks. But in a sense, you're not only protecting yourself against infection. And even for kids who get sick, I mean, I had the flu for the first time I remember when I was a medical resident. And I have never felt sicker.
When you had the flu or when you took
and
the flu
after
shot?
That, no, when I got the real flu.
Yeah, the flu's awful.
And, you know, it is really horrible. You are you're really febrile, you're vomiting, you cannot feel worse. And, you know, the flu shot, by and large, I mean, and we have data on, you know, millions of people who've gotten it. Mm-hmm. You know, people have sore arms, they feel maybe a little bit fatigued. Very, very infrequently do people develop fever. There are specific conditions, though. You know, if the flu vaccine is made in eggs and a person has an egg allergy, you know, you have to be very careful about those things. But again, you know, typically when you go to the doctor's office or to, you know, your CVS to get it, they go through the list of things. Be sure you don't have the following. We actually now have flu vaccines that are not made in eggs, which is, you know, an advantage, actually for several reasons. And then we also have now live attenuated vaccines, which your grandfather couldn't have gotten because they're usually given to people who are younger. But, you know, there are different options now, and there are actually even flu vaccines that can be made in insect cells now. So, you know, I guess we're getting better at it. But the other part is, you know, flu vaccines don't work well in the elderly. So, and one of the things is, you know, we do, they're the group that needs it the most.
Right. That's
because it's when people who are older who get the flu that they really have bad outcomes. And so improving the responses, either giving a larger dose or mixing the flu vaccine with something that makes it more potent, is actually very important. I mean, you know, it's difficult. It's hard to argue with individual cases of you know, people who have bad reactions to the vaccine. Because in general, what you're looking at, is populations of people. And, you know, not all vaccines are the same. I think it's the safest thing to say. So certain vaccines have different profiles of side effects. You know, I got the anthrax vaccine because I was in the military. And I can tell you, it hurts worse with every single vaccination. In your arm, right. It gets worse with every subsequent vaccination. That's a recognized phenomenon. And so you warn people about it, and it does.
That's interesting.
But, you know, again, so you, when we have these kinds of databases, we can and should inform people what the expected side effects are. And it's always the best practice, right? I mean, when you go to your doctor or if you go somewhere and you're having something done, you want them, the doctor or the nurse, the person giving the injection, to explain to you what you may be feeling.
Well, you know, but when you're getting a flu shot, it's working from what they learned from last year, right? Last year's strain and whatever the last years of whatever has gone by. Doesn't it mutate? How well does this year's vaccine work compared to last year's?
So the flu vaccines are actually picked about 9 months before, actually sometimes less than 9 months. And usually there's a pretty good match, but not always. Mm-hmm. And actually, I don't know this year's comparison to the circulating strains. Mm-hmm. I've been so focused on COVID. Sorry if I have
to. No, I want to just get some information on COVID in a minute. I had one more question on the vaccine thing, just because it's such a huge topic. You know, you read about it so much. Everybody's saying it leads to autism. You know, if you don't want it, your kids are going to get this, you're going to get that. What is your position on all that? Are we hearing the correct information about vaccines, and who do you believe?
So the autism connection was actually withdrawn from the journal, from The Lancet. Mm-hmm. It is not true. They've done, you know, lots of very detailed exams people who don't have conflicts of interest. And there is no connection. Mm-hmm. You know, there are vaccines do have side effects, you know, and it's important that we, you know, we can assure people that by and large, vaccines are safe and effective. You know, as I said, you know, over 80% of American parents give their kids, you know, maybe up to 26 or 27 injections for diseases that they've never seen. And, you know, those injections, the CDC has calculated over a 20-year period, It saved hundreds of thousands of lives, millions of hospitalizations, and trillions of dollars. And, you know, when you look in developing countries, the benefit is even greater. For every dollar you spend on vaccines, you save $16 in healthcare costs. So there's a huge societal benefit. And, you know, again, this is based on experience in developing countries, but, you know, children who are vaccinated are more likely to finish school. They have fewer issues with developmental delay, and they have better weight. Families are less likely to go into poverty because, you know, when a child is sick, a parent has to stay home. That means the parent is not earning income. So, I mean, there are all these other benefits to vaccination. And in the United States, those benefits are monetary because, you know, kids don't die of rotavirus diarrhea. They get hospitalized. There are, you know, costs of keeping your child in a hospital when they have a vaccine preventable case of diarrhea. So I'm pretty strongly in favor of vaccination. I think that, you know, childhood vaccines in particular are in general very well tolerated. Most American parents give them, and as a result, I mean, American children aren't dying in childbirth or at very young ages. If you look back in the 1960s and you look at the number of cases and the number of deaths from simple things like measles, you're really astounded. And it really drives home the enormous benefit that vaccines have brought to modern society.
Well, is there a sense that they're giving more and more vaccines that maybe some of them aren't required, or is we're giving them too early? How do you feel about that?
So, you know, we give vaccines for the diseases, you know, and again, all these vaccines go through a process. You know, the company provides data that the vaccine works, the FDA licenses it. There's a committee, an expert committee that reviews these vaccines and tries to decide whether or not to use them. So you may get a recommendation, as you do for the meningitis B vaccine, that, you know, they don't issue a blanket recommendation, but they say, you know, it works under certain circumstances. If your child is going to college and you're worried, well, you know, maybe you should consider having them vaccinated. There are other times when they issue a very definitive recommendation. You should use the following, vaccine. And they do a pretty good job of trying to make sure that they're both protecting the American population and or the American children and being very reasonable about, so how does this fit into the schedule? When you think about the burden of people I think are concerned that, oh, we're just giving people too many shots. You know, I mean, we as human beings are exposed to thousands of pathogens. And an infection, you know, for instance, an HIV infection, mm-hmm. you know, in the early stages of infection, you may have 100,000 to 1,000,000 particles of virus in every cc of blood.
Right.
And when you think about what you're getting in a vaccine, that amount is minuscule. And it's because we know exactly sometimes what to put into the vaccine. And we can give you what you need, and you'll develop a protective immune response against hepatitis A, because it's the exact right thing that we need in order to develop that response, or hepatitis B. You know, it's a simple protein. We inject it. It protects. It's not the whole virus. I mean, so again, the different vaccines are different. And when you think about COVID, you're looking at, you know, lots of different types of vaccines. Some of them are confusing. Some of them haven't ever been shown to be effective in humans, these like the RNA and DNA vaccines. Mm-hmm. But because of the horrible toll of this pandemic on, you know, 200,000 Americans, 1 million people dead around the world, there's a real pressure to get this done quickly, correctly, but quickly. And
I want to talk about that, because I think, you know, there's so much information shared about we're getting a vaccine soon, should be by the end of the year. No, it's going to be next year. And who's going to get it and who's going to manufacture it? They're doing all these trials all at the same time and in different, you know, putting their money on all the different things just to make sure that one of them comes out to be the winner kind of thing, instead of doing one at a time sequence. Is there a forerunner in your mind who what do you see time-wise of what's coming out, who's making it, and what can we expect?
Okay. You know, so this isn't that different from the situation with drug companies, right?
Right.
I mean, several drug companies could have different types of quinolone antibiotics, like
right.
ciprofloxacin and ofloxacin.
Right.
And different companies are testing different things, and you'll come up with slightly different indications, but in the end, you'll have two new antibiotics in the market. So the vaccine companies are kind of doing the same thing, and you're exactly right. You know, what the U.S. government said is, you know, we don't know which of these is going to work. So we will put $10.3 billion into making sure that we have enough of the different classes to be sure that at the end of the day, there will be a vaccine that is shown to be safe and effective. And when that vaccine is shown to be safe and effective, we don't want to have to wait 6 months for it to be manufactured. So what they're doing is they're making some educated guesses. They're saying, you know, RNA vaccine, Moderna, Pfizer, a chimpanzee adenovirus vaccine, that's the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, AD26 vaccine, that's Johnson & Johnson, Sanofi's working on protein. Now, they've broken the field down into different types of vaccines, and they're saying, okay, by probably November to December, we may have an interim look at some of the data. And at that interim look, if there are enough endpoints and if the vaccine is protective enough, then we might actually see an effect. We might actually see that this vaccine offers a certain level of protection. And we will have, you know, a significant amount of data, information on, you know, maybe a good portion of 30,000 people that says, you know, nothing, there are no serious side effects that are occurring in the first 3 to 5 months of vaccination, which is when, you know, the vast majority of bad side effects occur. So there will be a lot of information. It won't be complete information. So when faced with incomplete information, but a potentially good result, the FDA may say, well, we're not going to approve this. We're not going to give you market, you know, authorization, but we will give you emergency use approval on the basis of these preliminary data on safety and efficacy. I guess, was your question, who's in the lead?
Yeah. I mean, is it, which one's showing the most promise right now? And do you have an even know?
Yeah, that's a tough question because, you know, we don't know what protects.
Right.
So far, all of the non-human primate, the monkey studies that have been done, mm-hmm. all of the vaccines that are currently in phase three that have non-human primate studies, and mm-hmm. actually of the vaccines being tested in the United States and Europe, all of them do. All of them protect monkeys against infection.
Mm-hmm.
So you give the vaccine. You wait 4 to 6 weeks, or in one case, 12 weeks. You challenge with COVID-19, and the monkey is protected. How that will translate to humans, we don't know,
mm-hmm.
But it's hopeful information that the vaccines may protect. The other way you can look at it is to break the vaccines down into, you know, vaccines with the best response and vaccines with responses that are, you know, are medium range, and then vaccines with lower range. And so, you know, when you look at things like Moderna or a particular protein vaccine from a company called Novavax, mm-hmm. which is based, I think, in Maryland,
mm-hmm.
they generate very high levels of infection-fighting proteins. We call them antibodies that bind to and inactivate virus. We call it neutralizing antibody. So they have the highest level of neutralizing antibody. Now, Novavax, you may not have heard of because you know, they're not quite as advanced as some of the others,
mm-hmm.
Then you're looking at a broad range of others, the vaccine from AstraZeneca, the vaccine from Johnson & Johnson,
mm-hmm.
that are in a middle range of production of this infection-fighting protein. And, you know, is one better than the other? We don't know. The Johnson & Johnson vaccine may be effective after a single dose.
Mm-hmm.
Which would be a good thing, because the other vaccines are two-dose vaccines. The Moderna vaccine is in that same group, the RNA vaccine from Moderna. So it's in the middle range of things. So when you look at the, you know, the levels of this infection-fighting protein, and you look at where the vaccine companies are individually, AstraZeneca started in May. The Pfizer and Moderna trials in the U.S. started on the 27th of July.
Right.
And then Johnson & Johnson just recently started. So of those vaccine companies, you can kind of tell who's, in the lead right now because they vaccinated the most people. But their trial was paused by the company. This is AstraZeneca.
Mm-hmm.
Pfizer and Moderna, there's suspicion that Pfizer will have data soon. There's probably similar data from Moderna, although the CEO said that our vaccine probably won't be available in quantity until the middle of next year. So again, there are lots of things that could factor in. So the first thing is to prove that the vaccine works. And we might have that answer by the end of this year, maybe early next year. One of the vaccines, it works, it doesn't work, and is safe. But the next question, probably even more important question for people who want to be vaccinated, is when are we going to have enough vaccine to really be, able to vaccinate good parts of the American population? And that looks like it, although some of the companies are ramping up production now, it's probably going to be mid to 2021 before enough vaccine is available for there to be widespread availability of vaccine in the U.S., assuming that we can prove that one works. And then the next question is, okay, so we have vaccine. Now, how are you going to get it? Are we going to just ship it out to doctors' offices, hospitals, and, CVS or Walgreens? Or are we going to have a much more structured program? Are we going to line people up at work? Are we going to do it like we did the polio vaccine? Are we going to have, vaccinations in schools? So all of these questions are what the CDC asked the states to get ready for and to think about as they, quote, prepare for future COVID-19 vaccinations. And the one complication here is, unlike childhood vaccinations where you just take your kid to the, to the pediatrician or to the hospital for vaccination, with COVID-19, we're vaccinating adults and the elderly.
Right.
And that's not something we do commonly. I mean, maybe for the flu vaccine, but not everyone takes the flu vaccine. So again, we're going to have to work on being able to deliver vaccine to adults.
Well, like the flu vaccine, though, does this mutate at all? I mean, is it something that we have to have a new one every year? Is this going to be the panacea cure-all for all time? How does that work?
So I think that is a great question. So, we have a vaccine like the rotavirus vaccine, and it's been the same vaccine since 2007, and it's still very effective in America. Rotavirus doesn't mutate much. So the question that you're asking is, how much does COVID-19 mutate compared to flu?
Mm-hmm.
And we do have an answer to that. So a good way to think of it is, if you think of a pinprick in a car, so if you were to take a pin and poke it through a an index card, you'd see a little tiny hole.
Right.
If you think of that as the amount of sequence variation in the 70,000 or so COVID-19 viruses that we've sequenced, fully sequenced.
Okay.
And you think about flu, that amount of sequence variation in flu over the course of a year is about the width of the tip of your finger. So maybe 10 or slightly 8 to 10 times more sequence variation in flu. If you think about HIV in a single year in a single country, like Democratic Republic of Congo, it's the size of your palm, of your hand.
Wow.
So COVID-19 doesn't mutate much. Now, it only takes one bad mutation. And so far, we don't think that any of them are so significant that the current set of vaccines don't cover them. But we don't have a lot of data. We certainly don't have proof in humans that that's the case.
Mm-hmm.
So again, we've known about this virus for 9 months.
Yeah.
So we know an incredible amount, but you would be surprised, I think, or maybe not surprised, at the amount that we still don't know.
Well, everybody's shows Bill Gates's, talk about what we should expect all this. And you mentioned the Gates Foundation paying for certain things. How much preparation has there been for this kind of world event in terms of looking at what could be the next virus? And how surprising was it that what it turned out to be?
Yeah, that's a great question. Mm-hmm. So, coronaviruses have been an object of a particular amount of research because they jump from animals to humans. So the coronaviruses, people call them promiscuous, but not in the same way we think of promiscuous, but promiscuous in the sense that they can use more than one host. So when you think about the original SARS outbreak in 2002, that jumped from bats to something called civets, which are cat-like or mammal, and then from civets to humans.
Okay.
If you think about the Middle East respiratory syndrome, another coronavirus, another beta coronavirus, actually in the same branch of the family as SARS, MERS started in bats, jumped to camels, and from camels to humans. And then when you think about this coronavirus, the SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19 coronavirus, it started in bats, went through some, we think, maybe intermediate hosts. You know, at one point we thought they were spiny anteaters, pangolins. And now we're not sure exactly what, but it made the jump into humans. So coronaviruses are known to do this. A different group of coronaviruses is associated with, you know, mild cases of seasonal, you know, colds.
Right.
And, you know, those are the ones that are circulating North America, I mean, all over the world. So we've known about coronaviruses, and coronaviruses are one of the groups of viruses. You know, influenza has a cycle in birds and other mammals like pigs and then humans.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so there are groups of particular viruses that do make the jump, like, you know, HIV started in monkeys or chimpanzees and jumped over to humans, actually multiple times, probably over the course of a century before it actually became the outbreak that we know today. So there have been some attempts in the last 5 to 10 years to put together large programs to look at the kinds of, we call them zoonotic viruses, the viruses that exist in animals that can make the jump. And people are now developing, and they're still at an early stage, algorithms to identify what the biggest threats are. And one of those very large projects was actually canceled.
Why?
Before this outbreak. And, you know, I mean, research funding is research funding, so not everything continues forever.
Mm-hmm.
But that might have been a bit short-sighted in retrospect.
Hmm.
And maybe in the future, we will keep a better eye on these other viruses that really readily make a transition from animals to humans, knowing that they could be a future cause of potential infection. In fact, I think Dr. Fauci was just the author on a review with another scientist on some of the viruses that are capable of making the leap into humans. And that's something that we really need to take better care of monitoring in the future, the same way we do for influenza viruses. Because, you know, mm-hmm. what will COVID-22 be like?
You know, and what if it goes on to pets, dogs, cats, horses, whatever? Has that happened? And then what happens?
You mean if it leaves humans and goes back to animals?
Yeah, or if, you know, it starts with dogs. So you know how you're giving it through bats and all that. So why, if dogs become part of the process, then what happens?
Yeah, I mean, it would depend on, right. I mean, in the Middle East, camels, mm-hmm. you know, because they're a very common animal.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, people are very attached to camels and are very close to them.
Right.
Yeah, so it's potentially possible with lots of different with viruses, and depending on how the virus mutations are affect their ability to jump from, say, bats or other animals to humans, then yeah, it could be, we don't know. It's difficult to know.
That would be really challenging with, you know, how much people are attached to their animals, and if that happened. There's just so interesting to look at so much of this, and I know a lot of people are doing a lot of testing. I know since my husband's a physician, they do a lot of testing before he does surgeries on people. And it's, I've known a lot of people to take tests. Very few people come back who I've known have had them come back as positive. How accurate are they? And I've seen some of them are saliva tests. Some of them are nasal tests. Which one's most effective? Are they telling us the truth as far as are we positive or if we've had it at all? How accurate are they?
So right now there are a lot of tests out there, and they're very difficult to it's very difficult to know which test the company that, you know, is It depends on the company and what tests they're using. A lot of the tests, particularly early on, were just approved through emergency use authorizations, so they weren't really formally tested as well as they would normally be. And again, you know, depending on the test and depending on the condition, you know, maybe you want to have this RT-PCR test, which is, you know, kind of right now the gold standard for diagnosing infection,
mm-hmm.
current active infection.
Right.
They're developing a new series of rapid diagnostic, they call them antigen tests or antigen antibody tests. And some of them are looking much better. They're not as sensitive, but they're sensitive enough for the detection of active infection. And so they're useful. And their turnaround time is 5 minutes, and you don't necessarily have to have a hospital lab in order to get the result back. So, you know, that could be a real advance. They're starting to publish data on that, and you know, they're looking pretty good. The thing that we don't know yet, and this is where, you know, it gets into a little bit of the specifics here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the RT-PCR test is positive for extended periods of time, and actually probably is positive even after a person is not infectious anymore. The problem with the antigen and antibody test is, you know, sometimes it takes when you become infected with a virus, it takes the body a little while to generate the antibodies, the infection fighting proteins. You know, that could be 5 to 14 days.
Hmm.
And, you know, depending on the level of that antibody, it may be difficult to detect it at the early stages and much more likely to be picked up, you know, at 2 weeks or 3 weeks. But in the initial stages, in the very earliest part, some of that antibody will be sticking to the virus that's circulating in the body, so it could be falsely negative. So again, you know, one of the things that they need to do is not only test negative plasma and positive plasma, but they're actually going to look at people who are in the course of infection to understand, you know, when it is more likely that these tests, the new tests in particular, are going to be positive. And again, that's just, you know, we'll get more data at some point. But the newer tests are looking much more sensitive and specific than the first set of tests, the rapid tests that came out.
Well, if you have had it, your antibodies show up, can you get it again?
Yeah, good question. So that's actually one of the first questions you ask when you're thinking about a vaccine.
Right.
I mean, and with that, right? It's because in a classic vaccine pathogen combination, say polio or hepatitis A, your normal immune response attacks the virus, eventually controls it and eliminates it. And that same immune response protects you against reinfection. So you have immunity to reinfection. That's a great thing. And you know, the ability of the body to do that under natural conditions, under the conditions of natural infection, make it more likely that we'll be able to develop a vaccine against that pathogen. So with HIV, you can see how this works in reverse. The human body is never able to get rid of the virus. Your immune system can't get rid of HIV. It's been very difficult to develop an HIV vaccine.
Yeah. Well,
so the question that you asked, though, was on reinfection.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there are cases. There are cases emerging now of documented reinfection and reinfection with slightly different strains. And whether or not it's a common phenomenon or not is unknown, although the strong belief is that there's a certain amount of protection. And we don't know how long it lasts. You know, there was some data early on that when people get COVID-19 infection, that the level of infection-fighting proteins or antibodies in the blood is not particularly high. There was data that came out later that said, well, maybe if you have these killer cells or certain type of cell-based immune responses against the virus, that even though you couldn't measure antibody, that these T cells would protect you, would remember the virus and would attack it and kill it. Not only that, but maybe some of the T cells that were specific for the common cold type coronaviruses would also provide some level of protection. And we don't really know that's, I think, been hypothesized.
Mm-hmm.
It would be a very interesting thing if it were true. And I think that, you know, we're still waiting for more definitive proof that that's the case. And so how would you do that? Well, one of the ways to do it would potentially be to do a challenge study. You know, to take people who are COVID negative, and if they consent and they, you know, understand the risks of doing this and have no risk factors, so they would be young, they would be sure that they would be healthy, and that we could artificially infect them and then see if they could be reinfected, or we could vaccinate them and then challenge them. And, you know, that's something that we do for dengue. We've done challenge studies for malaria and cholera and typhoid. And, you know, there's actually recently an editorial in the New England Journal that said, well, maybe we should start thinking about a challenge model for COVID-19, because it would accelerate what we know and would actually make us feel more comfortable about, you know, are people actually protected, and for how long, and what do you have to have in your blood that protects you? You have to have massive quantities of neutralizing antibody, or will just having detectable antibody be enough? So again, these are really important questions, and people may make policy decisions based on this information. So again, it would be something that we could look into. And actually, there are over 10,000 people who had already volunteered to be in these challenge studies. We don't even have a challenge study going, but I think people are already saying, you know, sign me up.
That's interesting.
Let me know. Uh-huh. And yeah, I mean, it's a very, but you know, we've done it for other diseases. So it's not like this would be the first time. But the reason to do it is really pressing, which is we need to understand what protects people. If there's a way to accelerate vaccine development, that is also would be a good thing.
Is there a difference in blood? Does blood type have anything to do with how people respond to any of this? Is there any kind of difference in, you know, we know younger people don't get it as bad as older people and all that type of thing. What are you seeing are the biggest differences in how people respond to the infection? Is it mostly just age?
Yeah, it may be the way, you know, there are two forms of the immune system.
Mm-hmm.
The one that we've been talking about, we call the adaptive immune system. Mm-hmm. It's highly specific for the pathogen. So, mm-hmm. you know, it's one of the amazing things about, you know, the evolution of the human defensive or immune system is that we've got this immune system that eventually develops responses that are highly specific for the virus that infects you. So, you know, if you were exposed to measles virus, you would develop antibodies against measles. Now, those antibodies would not protect you against mumps or rotavirus.
Right.
But they do protect you against measles. And if you were to encounter measles again, those antibodies would protect you against measles in the future. So we call that the adaptive immune response.
Mm-hmm.
There's a different immune response that's actually more primitive. And it really functions to, you know, activate the body and warn it that there's something going on. And we call that the innate immune response.
Hmm.
And the innate immune responses in younger kids or in the elderly could be different. And that actually shapes the adaptive immune response.
I see.
So people talk about the dysregulation of the immune response being responsible for some of the negative consequences, you know, but I think at this point we still are guessing around what, you know, actually there have recently been some papers on why children do better. You know, their initial immune responses to the virus may be make them less prone to have the severe consequences
mm-hmm.
compared to adults. But again, you know,
there's more research to be
difficult.
Done. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, this is all really fascinating. And I know there's just so many questions everybody has, but you really touched on so many of the things that I think a lot of people are asking. And it's so great to have you on the show talking about this, because it's such a important and scary topic that a lot of people don't know, you know, the answer. So I really enjoyed our conversation in that respect, because we were able to shed some light on some of these important questions. Now, is there some kind of a site or something you'd like to share for people who want to know more or to follow you?
So, you know, the IVI website has usually posts all the interviews that the staff at IVI, not only myself, but other people who are doing vaccine development as it relates to COVID or the work that IVI is doing on COVID.
Mm-hmm.
I think, you know, I've done a lot of interviews recently, so mm-hmm. there's, you know, different areas and topics. I think we just actually did a blog post for NBC, a number of colleagues from mm-hmm. around the world.
Right.
And so you can Google those as well. But the IDI website should contain a list of recent media posts.
Great.
But, you know, again, if people have questions, you know, I think through you, they can ask, or okay. I'm happy to.
Yeah, I would be happy respond. To forward those along. And your impressive history of, you know, your work, having an MD from Yale and everything that you've done is really fascinating. And thank you so much, Dr. Kim, for being on the show. I really enjoyed our conversation.
Thank you, Dr. Hamilton. And it was really a pleasure to speak to you. Such a really insightful question. Thank you.
And we will be back right after this message. Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate. Well, I'd really like to thank Dr. Kim for being my guest today. We get so many great guests, and this was really a fascinating and timely show. I hope you take some time to check out Dr. Kim's work and check out some of the past episodes if you've missed any. If you're looking for the show, you can find it, of course, on all the podcast stations and our AM FM stations. But you can also go to my website at drdianehamilton.com and find out more. If you go to the blog there, you can actually read the show. So anything that we talked about here will be linked to, which is kind of nice. So I hope you take some time to do that. And I hope you enjoyed today's episode. And I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.